Good evening. Hello, welcome to the Deschutes Land Trust Nature Night Speaker Series. I'm really looking forward to this evening's topic, as I'm sure you are too. I'm Jana Hempel, the Community Engagement Manager for the Deschutes Land Trust. We'd like to begin this evening by respectfully acknowledging that we are visitors to the historical territories of the Warm Springs, Wasco, and Paiute bands of Native Americans. These bands are represented today by the Confederated Tribes of the Warm Springs Reservation of Oregon. The Deschutes Land Trust considers the Confederated Tribes of Warm Springs an important partner in management and restoration of our protected lands. These tribal communities are the original stewards of the land, helping care for and connect with the land since time immemorial. You can learn more about Central Oregon's local Native American communities by visiting the museum at Warm Springs, listening to Warm Springs Radio at KWSO 91.9, or visiting the Confederated Tribes of Warm Springs website. The Deschutes Land Trust mission is to conserve and care for the lands and waters that sustain Central Oregon, so local communities and the natural world can flourish together for generations to come. We are passionate about land conservation. Thanks to important partnerships with landowners, our community, and more than 1,700 households that donate to our work, we've protected 18,742 acres of land and counting. Yes, which is worthy of applause. The Land Trust cares for our protected lands, their wildlife, native plants, and clean water, both now and for future generations. If you'd like to work with us to restore local creeks and forests, help wildlife adapt to climate change, and connect our communities to the outdoors, you can join us by donating online at DeschutesLandTrust.org, volunteering both outdoors or inside, sharing about us on social, or telling your friends and family about how amazing our work is. And it's not just me and other staff doing this amazing work, or our board, but it's also our donors, our volunteers, and our partners. So let's give a big round of applause for everything that's been accomplished together as a community. In preparation for tonight's presentation, a quick reminder to please silence your cell phones. We will be taking questions to ask the presenter after their presentation via a website called Menti. If you'd like to ask a question, please go to menti.com, that's M-E-N-T-I.com, and type in the code 3564-2731. For those of you watching via live stream, you can participate through Menti as well. We will be sharing this slide again at the end of the presentation, so don't worry about getting the info right now. You can also go to menti.com and enter the code at the end of the presentation when we're taking questions. In the coming days, we will be sending you an email with a link and resources to tonight's presentation, so keep an eye out for that arriving in your inbox. And now for tonight's presentation. James Johnston is an assistant professor at OSU College of Forestry. He holds a bachelor's degree in history from the University of Oregon and a master's and PhD in forest science from Oregon State University. His research interests include fire ecology, dendroecology, restoration forestry, environmental law and policy, and collaborative governance. Let's give a warm welcome to James Johnston.
Thank you.
So, thank you so much.
Thank you so much. The third time is a trot. The third time is a charm. I so appreciate being here in Bend tonight. I'm sure everyone here has heard this before, but I love your town. I wish I could spend more time here. My co-presenter and collaborator in Eastern Oregon tree ring research, Andrew Merschel, was not able to join me tonight. He has kid duty tonight. He has a class to teach in the morning, and the conditions on the pass didn't allow us to guarantee to get him back to his class in time, so I'm proceeding without him. I don't have a script. This might be more of a conversation than a lecture, but please bear with me. This presentation is about fire, and it's about old trees, and it's about tree ring research. I have a lot of background to get into before I get to the tree ring part of the presentation. I hope you'll bear with me. I have instructions kindly provided by the Deschutes Land Trust. My eye is immediately locked on these lines. Maps, graphs, tables are not recommended. I want you to know that I would never, ever, ever bore the good people of Bend with graphs, tables, maps, et cetera, et cetera, without warning you first. So, maps and graphs to follow, but don't worry, I'm a professional. Few of my audience members have been seriously harmed by the maps and so forth. Hey, this is a nice, friendly map of the great state of Oregon. I want to tell you a little bit about Andrew and I. These are our hometowns. And I wanted also to show a map of public lands in Oregon. Everybody that lives in Bend knows that we're blessed to have lots of public land. 61 million acres of public land in Oregon. That's 53% of the state. Everyone here that mountain bikes, skis, hikes, do they mountain bike and ski in this town? Uses and enjoys public land. Everyone that drinks beer in this town, which is everybody, the water comes from public lands, and I can go on and on and on. Everyone with a heart and soul enjoys public lands. So the public lands where Andrew and I are from, the Coast Range of Oregon, are some of the luscious, most luxuriant ecosystems on Earth. The iconic tree of the west side of the state is our friend here, the Douglas fir. Why is there so much biomass in the west side of the state? Well, it's extremely productive. Because it's extremely productive, it's one of the most important softwood lumber-producing regions in the world. We can't talk about old trees without talking about old-growth logging. I believe this to be the last old-growth timber sale that was ever offered in the west side. This is on the Willamette National Forest in 2002. Why is it so moist and productive? Well, because it's so moist and productive, here's a map of precipitation. And the most important thing to know about our state is that line that divides the state down the middle between east and west. Ocean storms from the Pacific cross over western Oregon, dump a bunch of water, and dump even more as they move up the mountains. There's very little water left to the east side of the state. So it's drier and sparer and can be kind of stark. But it's beautiful, and I spend as much time as I possibly can out here. It's fair to say that I've fallen in love with the forest and waters of eastern Oregon. The iconic tree species of eastern Oregon, of course, is ponderosa pine. But it's not at all the only tree species. And not all of the forest in eastern Oregon are these open park-like ponderosa pine stands. One of my favorite tree species is western larch, found in cooler, moister settings. One of the most fire-tolerant species in all of western North America. Here's a moist mix conifer stand composed of western larch, Douglas fir, and some grand fir. So there's pretty moist forest in eastern Oregon as well. So far today, I've only talked about variability in forests over space. What about variability in forests over time? What if we could take a time machine back to Oregon, to Eastern Oregon, and see what it looked like 150 or 200 years ago? Well, there's lots of tools that scientists and everyday people can use to appreciate what forests looked like 100 and more years ago. Photographs that are 100 years old. Don't forget to drink some water. Can be found. They're not necessarily objective representations of historical forests, although for what it's worth, this view of Eastern Oregon forest shows relatively open forest conditions, as does this photograph from 1913. My favorite way to learn about historical forest conditions is to read settlers' journals, and by far my favorite pioneer journal is Rebecca Ketchum, who was writing in 1853 in the Grand Ronde Valley. Her diaries are wonderful. She was a talented ecologist, a beautiful writer. She was sort of unique in people making, in women making the trip to Oregon, and that she did the Oregon Trail as a single woman. I've often kind of wished that I was single 170 years ago in the Grand Ronde Valley. And she describes most of it as a country that was burned regularly, which is interesting, right? There are, of course, exceptions. Here's the journals of John Charles Fremont from 1844, who complained about cutting his way through dense body of timber. Now, a couple notes here. First of all, I think that this is a case of the exception proving the rule. I'll say three other things about John Charles Fremont. And I'm actually going to get serious here. I'm going to show you in a little bit a slide. I'm giving you fair warning. And this is deadly serious. It's a slide that contains text that describes violence. It's impossible to talk about a history of trees without talking about a history of people. And the history of people in Eastern Oregon hasn't always been pleasant. So John Charles Fremont. First of all, he was kind of a whiner. Second of all, it's extremely unlikely that he actually wrote these words. Now, he did keep careful journals, and he took them back to his wife, Jessie Fremont. Her father was Thomas Hart Benton, as in Benton County, Oregon. And she did the writing. She was quite the writer as well. Here she is when her husband was running for president. An officer who had planted upon the highest peak of the Rocky Mountains, the stars and stripes had crossed prairies of ocean-like vastness, where the intruding foot of civilization had never before trampled down in its wildflowers, had braved the dangers of the tomahawk and scalping knife, blah, 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 blah. So, fair warning, I am going to move to this slide now. This slide's a different version of the explorations of John Charles Fremont, and it's an account written many years after the fact by one of the men who accompanied him. That's John Charles Fremont on the left, and his guide. He was guided in these travels by Kit Carson. I don't want to dwell too much on this side, and I promise you I will get back to the photographs and the wisecracks in just a second. This is very hard stuff to read, the truth. It wasn't a voyage of exploration or discovery. It was a murderous rampage through Eastern Oregon. The order was given to ask no quarter and to give none. We charged into the village, taking the warriors by surprise, and then commenced a slaughter of which is unequaled in the West. As I said, this is sort of hard stuff to read. We had orders while in camp or on the move to shoot Indians on sight. While on the march, the crack of a rifle and the dying yell of a native was not an unusual occurrence. I'm sharing these words first because it's important that we understand the true nature of our history in this part of the world, and also because I think that these words actually have significant bearing on my discussion of old trees and fire. And we'll return to John Charles Fremont at the end. There's some other interesting ways to learn about historical forest conditions in Eastern Oregon, and that's from the much more systematic and rigorous work of these folks. These are General Land Office surveyors, GLO surveyors. And all of the West, all of the United States, is divided up into a grid, a rectilinear grid of 1 square mile sections. And these folks hiked along. And whenever they reached the intersections of one of these section lines, like that, there's the intersection of one of the section lines, they recorded the distance to the nearest tree in each of those four quadrants, all over eastern Oregon. And you can do some fancy, rather daunting math and derive estimates of historical forest density. And except for one science paper, which is fairly controversial, most work with this data has shown that although there was variability, by and large, most of the forests of eastern Oregon were not nearly as dense as they are today. Other sources of information are timber inventories. One of my favorite scientists and good friend, Kayala Hagman, has done a lot of work with timber inventories. This one on the Warm Springs Reservation, just north of here. These timber inventories are old. They're from the 19-teens, 1913, 1914, 1916. She found that forests in this area were predominantly low density. She did similar work on the former Klamath Reservation south of us and found that a historical landscape emerges which supports current working hypotheses that frequent low to moderate severity wildfire maintained a predominantly low density forest dominated by large fire and drought tolerant ponderosa pines across a significant moisture and productivity gradient from the driest ponderosa pine to the mixed conifer habitat types. There's something else I was going to say about Kayala's work. Maybe it'll come to me later. At any rate, there's another way to learn about historical forest conditions, and that's the work that Dr. Marshall and I do, and that's tree ring science. Here you see a piece of wood. The very center, and the center of this has been eroded by deterioration, the passage of time, et cetera, et cetera. Right there in the middle of the tree, we call that the pith. And the tree is adding concentric radial growth outward every year. Trees grow every year. So they leave not only a record of climate, well, they leave all sorts of records. Long-lived conifer trees like ponderosa pine, western larch, Douglas fir, are hydroclimatically sensitive, which is just a fancy word that means that in dry and warm years, the rings are relatively narrow. And in cool and moist year, the rings are wider. And each sequence of years is its own distinctive pattern. They're as unique as a human fingerprint. And we use some of the same computer algorithms that folks use to identify fingerprints to assign to each and every one of these tree rings a calendar year such that we know that that's the year 1739. Followed, I should add, by a relatively significant drought in the year 1740. Some of you may have seen our friend, this ponderosa pine that's out in the lobby. If you haven't, go check it out. These trees live a really long time. Many of them are 600 and 700 years old. Back to the map. These are all the sites in which Andrew and our colleague Emily Heyerdahl have conducted tree ring research, and I'm going to share some of the results of that work with you. I'm first going to talk about, well, of course I'm going to talk about our study sites closest to Bend, Oregon. But first, oh yeah, I threw in this slide at the last moment. He couldn't be here. That's Dr. Andrew Marshall in the tree ring laboratory of the College of Forestry at Oregon State University. Andrew hates this photograph.
As well he should.
Which is why I like to share it as often as I can. The best part of the lab is this fancy machine, and there it is with one of our ponderosa pine friends, and it's measuring each and every single one of those rings to 1/100th of a millimeter precision, which is exactly, I don't know if you can see that from back there. The College of Forestry Tree Ring Laboratory currently has data for, I think it's 2.1 million tree rings, most of which are from eastern Oregon. Who's a woodworker in the audience? Yeah. I just had to show you some photographs of tree rings. They're beautiful. They're like wine. They get better with age. They often have some color to them, primarily as the result of fungal activity. Each of these tree rings encodes a specific pattern related to climate that allows us to cross-date them or assign to each ring a calendar year. But each tree ring is also different. And they're all, each of them, really, really, really beautiful. Okay, so I said I was going to talk about Ben, but I lied. I am. But first, I need to give you some background about exactly what we do. Tree ring research is a little like hunting or fishing. And what we're hunting for are these sorts of features. This is a stump. We only do this thing to dead trees, and there's lots of dead trees out there. There'd be considerable moral hazard to doing this to a live tree, but this is a stump that's long dead. And what we're interested in is that oval-like feature in it. What I'm going to do next is I'm going to cut off about 6 inches off the top of that stump with a chainsaw, and then I'm going to stand on the stump, and I'm taking a photograph looking down into that cavity, which tree ring scientists call and loggers call a cat face. They're relatively common in ponderosa pine. And if you look at those little nicks and crannies on the side there, they actually do look a little bit like a cat's whiskers. So there's our cat-faced feature. And I'm going to saw off a couple more partial cross-sections that are about 6 inches deep off the top of this thing with a chainsaw, and sand them to a fine polish. That's a good part of what I do for a living, is I sand. I sometimes tell people that I have a PhD in industrial arts, and it's not far from the truth. So we sand them so that we can resolve that ring structure. And we are interested in those whiskers, the cat's whiskers. So let me zoom in on one small portion of this piece of wood. And do you see those whiskers at the top? Those lines that are in between the tree rings. And that is where a fire heated the cambium. The cambium is that inner part of the tree just inside the bark, which is the only part of the tree that's alive. Killed the cambium, but it didn't kill the tree. It just left a scar, and the tree healed over that scar and enclosed part of the scar and kept on growing for hundreds of more years. Now, again, this wood is hydroclimatically sensitive, and we're able to cross-date it with that fancy piece of equipment such that we can assign to each and every one of those whiskers, each and every one of those fire scars, a calendar year, like so. It's a fire in 1833, a fire in 1829, a fire in 1822, and a fire in 1815. And now we have one slice of a history of fire in old growth forests of eastern Oregon. And now I'm going to show you the graph, the mother of all graphs. The worst, most incomprehensible graph that's ever been shown in the Tower Theater of Bend. If you have a heart condition, some other existing health condition, close your eyes. I'm gonna ease you into it. What I'm gonna do with this graph is I'm gonna create a timeline. The same timeline that encompasses this piece of wood from the year 1810 to 1875. And all I'm gonna do is place these fires on the timeline, like so. 1874, 1858, 1849, 1839, 1833, 1822, 1829, 1822, 1815. I'm representing fires on the timeline as a little red triangle, since that sort of reminds you of a campfire, right? Okay. We're not quite ready for the graph yet. Let me show you some more. Let's show you a history of fire for the for our study site closest to Bend. This is Winoga Buttes, one of the fire history projects that Andrew completed somewhere between 2012 and 2014. Here's Andrew in the field. He's sawing off the top of one of these ponderosa pine stumps. Note that cat-faced feature. There he is. He's going to grab that up and hike it back to the pickup truck and drive the pickup truck to Corvallis, and he's going to sand it for like a day. I come by every once in a while. I'm like, you done sanding that yet? Okay, so here's our timeline. And there's the same thing, except it's all those trees from all those sites right next to Bend. This is the complete history of fire of the Winoga Buttes area. It's what, 10, 15 miles southwest of Bend, right? Anybody been there? So it's a complicated graph, but honest to God, there's only three things that I get from it. And there's only three things I want you to get from it. The first is, there was a lot of fire at this site for hundreds of years prior to the present day. Second, fire just ceased towards the end of the last century, almost like water turned off from a faucet. There were a few little drips, drip, drip, but fire stopped. This timeline doesn't go to the early 1800s like the first piece of wood. This one goes from 2000 all the way back to 1300, 1400, thereabouts. And so that's the third thing I want you to get from this graph, is that there was a lot of old trees. So Andrew and his crews hike to a spot. The computer picks the spot. They just hike to it with a GPS unit. And they generally search for a fairly small area, generally a radius of about 100 yards in every direction. And at every single one of those sites, they were able to find an old, dead ponderosa pine that was older than 300 years old, and most of them were 400 or 500 years old, and many of them were 600 or 700 years old. There was a lot of fire. There was a lot of old trees. Old ponderosa pine like this. And it is absolutely positively not the case that there was a lot of old trees in spite of fire. There was a lot of old trees because of fire. Fire that burns that frequently is not severe fire, because it's burning so frequently that it's removing the fuel that you would need in order to have a very high severity stand replacing fire. So what this surface fuel is doing is it's killing other trees, killing all but those big, old, highly fire resistant ponderosa pine. The fire is what allows those big old growth trees to get to be 300, 400, 500, 700 years old. These forests need fire. Let's move to the east, to some of my work on the Malheur National Forest. This is the Malheur National Forest, another two-hour drive east of us. I'm going to focus on 10 different fire history study sites. And what's interesting about these study sites is that they were selected in a random stratified procedure, such that we located points within the full, we randomly located points within the full range of the different forest types that are found in eastern Oregon, ranging from very cool and moist to very warm and dry. So there's dry ponderosa pine sites, just like the sites outside of Bend that Andrew worked in, but there's also some pretty cool and moist sites. Here's some of our tree ring data from this Malheur National Forest study. Again, really frequent fire recorded in these old growth ponderosa pine. Each of those whiskers is a fire that killed part of the tree, but not all of the tree, and it subsequently healed over. Those dots in pencil, by the way, are shorthand for years. Three dots is 100 year, 10 dots is 10 year increment, and two dots is 50 year increments. In addition to sanding, I count to 10. Over and over and over and over and over again. Well, this is not a ponderosa pine. This is actually a Douglas fir. Dead Douglas fir recovered from one of those really moist mixed conifer sites, not unlike the photo I showed you in the introduction of the Douglas fir western hemlock. So even the moistest and coolest locations in eastern Oregon were experiencing very frequent fire. Why is that? They're very cool and moist, but they're still hot and dry in the summer. And there's still ignitions from lightnings and possibly from other sources as well. Here's the graph from the Malheur National Forest, and it's totally different from the graph from near Bend, but also pretty much the same. There was a lot of fire. The fire abruptly ceased at the end of the 1800s, and there were a lot of old trees. Again, these old trees need fire. I wanted to represent to you visually what these different forest types look like. It's not the case that there's only two forest types in eastern Oregon. There's probably at least 4 or 5 or 6 or 100 distinctive forest types. And there's really just an environmental gradient of anything and everything in between. But for some simplicity's sake, I divided this data set into two different forest types: dry ponderosa pine forests, which were historically composed almost entirely of ponderosa pine and are today composed almost entirely of ponderosa pine. And historical fire frequencies in these sites range from 11 to 18 years. So on average, every 11 to 18 years, there was a fire occurring in these sites. Here's a moist mixed conifer site. There's very little ponderosa pine or other fire-tolerant species there today, although you can occasionally find them. Mostly it's grand fir. Historical fire frequencies that are a little bit longer, it's about every 12 to 21 years. Most of these sites, by the way, the longest fire return interval is the one that we're in right now, which is to say from the late 1800s to the present day, close to 150 years, to give you an idea of just how departed these forests are from the fire cycle that they need and that they depend on. Another part of our research in in the Malheur National Forest involves reconstructing historical structure and composition from tree ring data. We core live trees using a hand-powered increment borer. I used to do a lot of this work myself, screwing a steel rod into a tree. It doesn't hurt the tree. We're able to extract one of these 5.15 millimeter cores. I mostly just drive around and watch other people do the work these days. So we core live trees, we saw up dead wood. And we take it back to the tree ring facilities and we sand it and sand it and sand it. I said we core live trees. We core live trees, including these big old-growth ponderosa pine. Again, punching a small hole in them does not harm the tree, I promise. This is a hand-powered 32-inch increment borer. It takes anywhere from 20 minutes to 3 hours to screw one of these tree cores out of these old-growth ponderosa pine. And we often core them more than once in order to intercept the pith, or the very center of the tree. And if you're wondering just how insane that is to try and hit the dead center of a tree that size. So we have a history of fire, and we also have a history of forests, a history of tree establishment. It's like how if you knew exactly how old everyone in the room was, except it's a room full of trees and we know exactly how old they are, which is really neat, and we can learn a lot from these tree demographics. Here's a classic mixed conifer stand in the Malheur National Forest, and here's the age of these trees. This grand fir is 24 inches diameter at breast height, and it's 110 years old. This one's even bigger. It's about 27 inches in diameter. It's 132 years old. These ponderosa pine are not much bigger in size, but they're much older. They're 398 and 400 years old. Here's another site. There's a western larch that's 253 years old, a Douglas fir that's 171 years old, a bunch of grand fir that are pretty good size, but they're actually relatively young, 81, 79, and 72 years, 62 years old. I don't think I put ages on those in the back there, although they were 400 or 500 years old. Any guesses how old this tree is? Anybody? Sir? 600? Well, I took the hard way to figure that out. I just want you to know that. As you sit there, relaxed. A lot of old ponderosa pine, a lot of large but young grand fir. Here's a table. Basal area is nothing more than the cross-sectional area of a forest stand. It's pretty closely related to just biomass. So let's just say biomass. And this is the change in biomass by species over time in forests of the Malheur National Forest. The amount of ponderosa pine biomass in these stands has increased by 57% in the last 150 years. The amount of Douglas fir biomass in these stands has increased by 924%. The amount of grand fir has increased by 2,346%. Again, almost all of that grand fir, it's pretty large because it grows fast, but it's really quite young. It's a more fire-sensitive species. It's easily killed by surface fire, especially when it's young. Even young ponderosa pine are relatively fire-resistant, and that's why the historical forest was composed largely of ponderosa pine. It survived that surface fire. Western larch, it's unprofessional for me to have favorites, but my favorite's western larch, has declined by 57%. So you guys like tables, don't you? You wish there was more tables. There's the western larch. Of course, we publish papers all the time in the scientific literature. I summed up what I have learned about eastern Oregon forests and change over time in this 2018 paper. We used multiple lines of evidence, including those general land office records and the tree ring reconstructions. We found the good agreement between the results of dendroecological, that's tree ring, research, reconstructions, and analysis of general land office records should give managers a high degree of confidence that significant reductions in basal area and density across a wide range of forest types are necessary to restore historical conditions. So what in the heck happened that there was this dramatic of change over time? We don't know exactly, but we got a pretty good idea, and the first culprit is livestock. There were hundreds of thousands of sheep and cattle all over eastern Oregon, mostly grazing, totally unregulated, mostly to feed and clothe mining camps, of which there were tens of thousands of people living in mining camps in eastern Oregon beginning in the 1860s. Gold was discovered on the Malheur National Forest, 1865, give or take a year. Here's cows, but that's not what I want you to look at. What I want you to look at is the surface here, which is mostly dirt, because it has been completely grazed by cattle. Even in the hottest, driest months of summer, even with ignitions from Native Americans, even with ignitions from lightning, you could not get this to burn. You could pour a gallon of gasoline on the ground and you'd have trouble getting a fire started because there's no surface fuel. All the grass has been eaten, and when all the grass has been eaten, all the surface fuel has been eaten, there can't be any more surface fire. So the surface fire that the old growth trees need to survive has been removed by cattle. Here's another scene in eastern Oregon where, again, this is just bare rock and dirt after being grazed in totally unregulated fashion for 10 or 20 years. The other thing that happened is that we removed a lot of those old growth, fire-resistant ponderosa pine. We live in one of the great, eastern Oregon, the area around Bend, the southern Blue Mountains, along with the Mogollon Rim, the Black Hills of South Dakota, are one of the great yellow pineries of the world. And there was a lot of old growth ponderosa pine cut in this country, beginning in the 19-teens all the way through the 1980s. I should have put a photo of the old mill district in Bend up here. The last culprit is this guy. They caught him in the act. This is an early Forest Service ranger, and he's just doing his job, which is putting out fires, which was pretty easy in those days when it was just surface fires burning through grass. You could put out the fire with a coat or a blanket. He's probably using the same blanket that he sleeps with at night. So fire suppression. We removed the fire that the old growth needs. What's happening now? Well, significant increases in forest density, particularly grand fir, as I said. These are all grand fir that have infilled into stands that were previously much more open. And look at the surface fuel loading. There's a foot and a half of duff and litter. It needs the right conditions to get a fire going, but when a fire does get going, it's pretty hard to stop. And that's the fundamental consequence of fire suppression, is that it puts out the fires that are easy to put out. It puts out the fires that you could put out with a blanket, so that the only fires that burn anymore are burning through a foot and a half of duff and litter and woody debris under hot, dry, and windy conditions that inevitably become a crown fire. Here's one of our long-term research plots on the Malheur National Forest that's been infilled by grand fir. I have had long-term research ongoing in eastern Oregon for 12 years, which is not a long time. I know there's people here that have been out in these woods for longer. But even in those 12 years, we've seen dramatic change. Here's that site after I revisited it for the second time. Every single one of the old growth ponderosa pine killed because the grand fir served as ladder fuels that carried the fire into the canopy of those old growth pines. Historically, these trees are well protected from fire because all the live surface vegetation is 150 feet in the air and because they're relatively widely spaced. And surface fire could burn all day against the base of one of these trees without killing it. Significant increase in fire activity, much of it high severity fire, in eastern Oregon. It has always been the case that there were dense forests in eastern Oregon, some places, somewhere. And there's always been high severity fire that burned through those dense forests and left patches of high severity fire. But this type of forest fire has no historical analog. When you see dead trees for miles in every direction, in a forest that historically burned every 10 years or so, removing surface fuels and nurturing these old growth trees. This is not something that this landscape has seen in hundreds of years and perhaps not ever. Even in the absence of fire, or even in the absence of wildfire, we're still losing old growth trees to drought and insect mortality as a direct consequence of competition with younger, more shade tolerant species like grand fir. These are more of, trees in our long-term research plot, which were alive when we measured them 10 years ago and are dead now. I know you guys have been wondering, what does this guy's house look like? This is my upstairs guest bedroom. And it's got it's got the same thing you all have got. I've got a few books. I've got a fan. I took the mirror out of my bathroom when I was painting the bathroom like 2 years ago, and I haven't put it back, which is why I don't shave anymore. Got my vacuum cleaner and my mop. And I've got like all these tree cores of thousands of trees. Let me zoom in on this. It's a little forest of tree cores in my bedroom. And as I said, we core these trees to the dead center of the tree, low to the ground, so we know when the tree was born. I'll zoom in on that. That's the pith of the tree. So I'm going to show you one more graph, just one more. This is the last one. So here it is. It's another timeline. Instead of years, I'm going to put age, the age of trees, okay? And we know when these trees were born because we cored them to the pith, to the center of the tree, when they were just about that tall. There's that tree. It was born almost 490 years ago. So I'll just put a tick mark on that timeline. You with me? And I'll just populate it with all the other tree cores from my upstairs guest room. And now we have, it's like a census. It's the demography of trees that I sampled in roadless and wilderness areas on the Malheur National Forest about 10 years ago. And I did this in roadless and wilderness areas that had never been logged because I was trying to reconstruct historical forest conditions, and you can't do that when a bunch of trees were removed by logging. So these are all sites that there hasn't been any logging. So I had an opportunity to revisit these trees last summer, hiked around and relocated them all. It was like visiting old friends. It was kind of sad because many of them had died. So what I'm going to do now is show you how many of these have died in the last 10 years by graying out those ones that have died. And let me tell you, it's a little unprofessional again, but it's hard when you see a tree that was you visited for the first time and it was 600 years old and it's dead just 10 years later. It really could have and should have lived to be another 100 or 200 or 500 years old. But there's no fire in these forests. There's none of the disturbance that kills young trees that's necessary for these old growth to persist over time. 24.5% of my trees on the Malheur National Forest have died in the last 10 years. If there's an insurance agent in the crowd, they can tell you that you just move the decimal point one place over to get the annual mortality rate of old growth trees. 2.45%, which doesn't sound like a lot, but that's 2.45% of the old growth in eastern Oregon, a year that we're losing. And that adds up pretty quickly. What can we do about it? I think we really should do something about it. The key ingredient to the solution is people. Here's members of the Blue Mountains Forest Partners, which convenes representatives from the timber industry, from conservation groups, local elected officials, out in the field planning restoration treatments. Here we are visiting a wildfire. And here's some of the projects that the Blue Mountains Forest Partners have planned on the Malheur National Forest. This is one of these really dense stands of ponderosa pine. Most of the old growth trees were removed by logging about 80 to 90 years ago. And here's what the same stand looks like after thinning. Quite a bit of tree removal, a much more open forest. Here's another stand in a moisture mixed conifer site prior to thinning. And yeah, of course, I cored these trees. I was not able to get this to the center of this grand fir. This grand fir was 27 inches in diameter. I wasn't able to get to the center, but I got it close enough to the center that I could tell you it was somewhere between 85 and 100 years old. It's one of these trees that have grown up in the absence of fire because of fire suppression, and it's competing with the older 300-year-old pines in the stand. So here's the same site after logging. You can actually see the 300-year-old pines, and the grand fir is gone. And you know, these logging shows can be kind of sad. It is a much more open forest. But this is much more like what the forest used to look like historically. And it's much better suited for the persistence of these old trees in the future because there's less competition. And we can have a fire in this forest now that's not going to kill the old trees by climbing the grand fir fire ladders up into the canopy of old growth trees. We're learning a ton about these forests. We're not just cutting down trees. We have an extensive multi-party monitoring program that's examining the ecological effects of these thinning shows. Here's my field crew at work out in the Malheur National Forest, measuring trees, measuring surface fuels. We're learning a lot about understory vegetation, and there are indications that thinning increases diversity of understory vegetation because there's more solar radiation reaching the forest floor. There's indications that we're significantly enhancing aspen habitat. Aspen is one of the most critical ecosystems in the American West. There's biodiversity way out of proportion in aspen stands compared to other forest stands in eastern Oregon. Aspen is a relatively short-lived species that needs disturbance in order to regenerate. Here's a stand where there's nothing but a few old and dying aspen stands immediately following selective conifer removal, which maintained those big old-growth ponderosa pines. And here's the same scene just 3 years after thinning. Massive response of aspen, much more capable habitat for birds, small mammals, and other critters that use aspen stands. We continue to find new and interesting ways to punch holes in trees, and we're learning that ponderosa pine following thinning have enhanced radial growth, enhanced leaf area, enhanced mobilization of non-structural carbohydrates, and no, you don't need to know what that means, but it's a good thing. It means that these trees are much more resistant to fire and insects. We are relinking that characteristic pattern process feedback that maintained old growth over time. We did a pilot study investigating pollinator diversity and found increased pollinator diversity in thin stands. We're going to bring online a larger research project beginning this summer to test hypotheses about the influence of thinning on diversity of pollinator species. And, you know, birds and bears are, all that stuff is great. But we'd be absolutely screwed if we lost pollinators. And so it's critically important that we examine the influence of these thinning treatments on pollinators. I'm almost done. Last thing, second to last thing. The proof is really in the pudding when wildfire encounters one of these thin stands, which is happening more and more frequently on the Malheur National Forest as there's more wildfire and there's more thinning. This is a stand that was thinned in 2018 on the Malheur National Forest. Thinning was completed in 2018. You can see it's a much more open forest. Think back to that forest that I showed you earlier. And here's it is immediately after the Black Butte fire burned it in 2020. Almost every single one of these trees is badly singed by a pretty hot wildfire, but almost all of them are going to survive. Here's another scene after thinning, but before fire, after fire, This is actually one of those areas where we had one of our long-term research plots, and so far we've noted about 3% mortality and 1% mortality of the oldest trees following wildfire. These thinning treatments are working. And here we are really at the end. This is how I wanted to end. This is a ponderosa pine snag on the Malheur National Forest. It's got some unusual features to it. This bottom feature here is just one of those cat face features that I've talked about before that are the result of repeated surface fire. But the top part of that feature is something else entirely. And I'll zoom in on it here. I haven't had time tonight to talk about the application of tree ring methods to archaeology questions. And I have not talked a lot, well, I haven't talked at all, about Native Americans and fire. There is significant evidence, both from traditional ecological knowledge, from archaeologists, from ethnographers, that Native Americans were stewards of the land and they used fire as part of that stewardship. I'm not speaking to those issues because I'm not a holder of traditional ecological knowledge. I'm not an ethnographer and I'm not an archaeologist either. What I know is tree rings. But we were able to apply some tree ring methods to determine that this feature was created when someone using stone tools removed bark and cambium from the tree about 250 or 300 years ago. And shortly thereafter, they set a fire right up against the trunk of the tree, probably fed by the resin that was being exuded from that wound. It didn't kill the tree. The tree survived for at least another 150 years. It's dead now, but it survived this. I have no idea why they did that. I really don't. I wish that I did. At the end of the day, although I sound like an expert, I have more questions than answers about old growth forests and fire. I have a lot to learn about old trees and fire. But what I believe is that forest restoration, reweaving fire and forests, has the potential to be one small step towards reweaving that rich cultural heritage that John Charles Fremont and others and us did such great harm to. And I'm absolutely convinced, based on the weight of scientific evidence, that forest restoration is a giant step forward, in being able to ensure that forest fire and people can live together for generations to come. I'm going to end there. I want to thank the folks that funded our research in Eastern Oregon, and I hope you'll all take a little bit of time to read some acknowledgments, the people that were most important and critical in allowing me to put this information in front of you. And I don't know what time we're at, but I am hoping we have time for questions, right? We're at 8 o'clock.
Excellent. Thank you so much. That was fascinating. I don't know if there's anyone else in the audience that wants to immediately go out and hug an old growth ponderosa right now, but might have to wait until tomorrow. So yeah, we're going to do our Q&A, which is all online. So once again, if you can go to menti.com, and the code that you'll want to enter is 3564-2731. I didn't see any questions to start with, so I'm going to go ahead and ask the first question. As a community that wants to help our forests, what can we do just as, you know, your average community member to help them?
Everybody here has a stake in public land ownership. everyone here should be devoting part of their time to working for the protection of our public forests. There's lots of ways that you can get involved. One of the best ways, I think, is to be involved with the Deschutes Collaborative Forest Project. There's information about the group out here, and I'll be wearing their hat to remind you. Any questions from the audience? Raise your hand and I'll repeat. Yes, sir. Okay, and I'm going to repeat your question.
Thank you.
For the interest of the people joining us from the World Wide Web, and please, sir, correct me if I butcher your question. You say that there are a contingent of zero cutters, folks that want no logging on public lands. You consider that disinformation and are wondering what academics and others can do to counter that disinformation. I'll only just say this, and I'm quoting, well, quote the late, great senator, Democratic senator from New York, Patrick Monahan, who used to say, everyone in America is entitled to their opinion, but not everyone is entitled to their own set of facts. It is a free country, and there's lots of perfectly good reasons to dislike cutting down trees in our national forests. It's ugly, it's a hell of a mess, et cetera, et cetera. And I respect and value that opinion. And there are differences of opinion about the information I presented. I would just leave it to you all to judge for yourselves where those facts lie. Thanks for your question.
All right, next question. Is there any way, that wasn't the one I wanted to ask. How is the explosion of junipers affecting old growth trees and fire?
There's been extraordinary increase in junipers in eastern Oregon, along with increases of other tree species like conifer. Juniper expansion is happening primarily on the lower elevation range sites, although a little bit in upper elevation sites as well. I don't think that it's having as profound of effect on old growth trees as the expansion of conifer, Douglas fir, and other shade tolerant conifers, because most of the juniper expansion is happening in places that historically were treeless. But it's having profound effects on native biodiversity by sucking up water that's needed by sage, native perennial bunch grasses, et cetera, et cetera. And much of what I said about removal of conifer probably holds true, probably even more true of removal of juniper from rangelands. Thanks.
All right, why is old growth so important versus new growth?
Why is old growth so important
versus new growth?
Well, the new growth will be important once it's old growth.
Well said.
I strongly encourage all the new growth out there to strive for old growth. But don't be messing with the old growth. Find your own spot. Any other questions from the audience? Yeah, sir. You were asking about a difference between the age structure of the Malheur fire history graph versus the Bend fire history graph. The graph is sort of a mess. I probably should have arranged it from youngest to oldest trees, and I think it would have looked more similar, actually.
There seemed like there was a larger age distribution in the bins, and the mouth here, the individuals that were in the mouth here were kind of spaced out.
The individuals in the mouth here were sort of spaced out in a different age distribution
Yeah.
Yeah. I honestly don't know. I'll have to look at those graphs again and bug Andrew about it. I don't think that there is although the graphs may have indicated this, I don't think that there is necessarily a significant difference in the demography of old growth trees in the Malheur National Forest versus the Deschutes National Forest versus the Fremont, Wainema, Ochoco, or other national forests in eastern Oregon. Almost all sites have trees that are at least 300, often 400, and sometimes 500, 600, 700 years old. Old trees were historically really common across a huge variety of landscape settings, in part, again, because in almost every landscape setting there was extremely frequent fire, which seems to be necessary to have that old forest structure. Thanks for your question. I'm going to look at that again, and you could be onto something. Ma'am. You still don't understand my answer to the question of why old growth is valued more than new growth. I love the new growth. I'm new growth myself. We have significant evidence that historical forests were relatively low density forests. There was quite a bit of variability. There were dense forests. But overall, there were pretty low density forests composed primarily of older trees. There was always young trees. That's how there came to be old trees. But most young trees were killed by fire. Trees are a little bit like salmon in that they lay lots of eggs, and only a few of them get out to the ocean and return to spawn. So the new growth is important, but I don't think that we are running out of new growth. We've seen increases in new growth of grand fir, for instance, by 2,400 or so percent. What we're losing is the old growth, and we're losing it in large part because of the increased density of young trees and competition of young trees with those old growth forests. So, of course, new growth is important, but I suggest that we keep our eyes on and our focus on protecting those trees that are 300, 400, 500, 600, 700 years old, and that we're losing at a far faster rate than they can be replaced. Did I answer your question? Kind of. Okay. I'm getting warmer. Thank you.
We have multiple people from the audience that are asking about lodgepole pines and their relationship to fire. And their effect compared to things like grand firs.
I wish Dr. Marshall were here, because he, among his studies that I didn't discuss, was a study of lodgepole fire histories and lodgepole stand development on the Pumice Plateau to the south and east of here. And we often view lodgepole pine as a tree that grows relatively quickly and is relatively young. And by relatively young, I mean 100 years old. That's pretty young for a Western conifer. And it's consumed in stand-replacing fire. Andrew finds that there's far more complex fire histories of lodgepole pine in eastern Oregon, that a lot of those dense stands of lodgepole pine had lodgepole pine that are 250, 300 years old that survived multiple surface fires, and that most of the lodgepole on the site are lodgepole that were established following fire exclusion. I think Andrew's major message, if he were here, would simply be that lodgepole pine fire history and stand development, lodgepole pine dynamics are extremely complex. I'm sorry, that's not a very good answer, is it?
Well, they'll continue to have more questions than answers then. You can go to the audience. I'll keep perusing and see if I can get some collectives again.
Yes. Is it true that the large or old, did you say? Is it true that the old growth trees sequester more carbon than young trees? Yes. The larger a tree and the older the tree, the more carbon it has in it. Eastside forests aren't great at storing carbon. I hate to be the bearer of bad news. The maximum carbon storage of the most productive ponderosa pine sites in eastern Oregon is about 509 tons of carbon per acre. Versus in western Oregon, our upper maximum carbon storage is about 3,069 tons per acre. The most important thing, I believe, in terms of carbon storage dynamics in eastern Oregon is the stability of carbon stores, i.e. being able to maintain the carbon stored in the old trees that we have on the landscape now. I think that maintaining stable carbon stores in forests of eastern Oregon is going to involve removing some young trees. Because if we don't remove those young trees, they're going to kill the old trees that have more carbon in them. This is a pretty complicated issue, and I'd love to take more questions about it, but I'll let it go at that for now. Thanks for the question. Yeah.
What's the relative frequency of fires in that 12 to 20 year frequency started by lightning versus Native Americans?
What is the relative frequency of fire within that 12 to 20 year fire return interval? What is the relative frequency of fire started by natural causes like lightning or by people? Historically, indigenous people. I don't know.
What's the frequency of fire started by lightning now without people?
The frequency of fire started by lightning now as opposed to people varies dramatically the farther away from communities you are. In roadless and wilderness areas, almost 100% of the fire today is started by lightning. It gets closer to 30 or 40% when you get really close to a road or a human community. Yes? How do we, I think the question is, how do we date the age of a tree, get back to how old it was? By sampling, either from using a chainsaw to saw up a dead piece of wood, or an increment borer, a live tree, by getting to the very center of the tree, very low to the ground. A tree is growing outwards. So in the middle there, is the earliest year, and the earliest year that's really low to the ground is the birth date. And we actually do use some fancy statistics to adjust the birth date from right here where we cored it all the way down to mineral soil. How do we know when a tree died? The last year of radial growth present on the sample is sometimes the day that it died, but not always, because outer wood could have deteriorated. We don't often know when trees died. In the graph I showed you of the trees that died in the last 10 years, in most cases, I have no idea when they died. I know that they were alive 10 years ago and they're dead now. I don't, in most cases, have any idea what year between 2012 and 2022 they died.
Could you try to ask what year, how you determine that was the start of the year?
Oh, how do we know that was the year? We cross-date each piece of wood. What we do is we have a master chronology of known ring width indexes. It's stored in our computer. We measure each tree ring to 1/100 of a millimeter precision. Then we apply to each 50-year segment, lagged by 25 years, a negative exponential function to detrend the tree ring series. And then for each of those tree ring segments, we calculate a Pearson's product moment correlation coefficient. And a computer gives us the answers. It's the truth. These tree rings are hydroclimatically sensitive, so the pattern of rings is as distinctive as a human fingerprint. So the computer tells us which year is which. Although, if you do it for long enough, you can just look at it. And if you don't believe me, take me to one of those bars in Bend with the old exposed timbers, and I will visually cross-date it for you. I do parties. Marker years. You're asking about the most significant or dramatic events. 2002 was a pretty dramatic event. 1968 is one of the most important marker years for tree ring scientists, not because it's really, really narrow, but it's relatively narrow and it's surrounded by two really fat years. 1936 is a narrow year. 1890, 1893, 1880. 1840 is a very narrow year. 1823 is a narrow year. The 1750s are great. 1757, 1756, very narrow. 1755, extremely wide. 1753, very narrow. The most, and I could do this all the way back to the really significant drought in the late 1300s, which was preceded by a famous drought of the 1200s, which led to the abandonment of Pueblo settlements in the American Southwest. The deepest, biggest, baddest drought in the last 500 years in Eastern Oregon was probably 1581, perhaps 1757.
All right, another question.
Yeah. Comment more about the expansion of juniper beyond just its use of water. What is leading to juniper expansion? Probably the biggest factor is fire suppression. We're keeping fire out of these rangeland systems. Juniper is an extremely fire-sensitive species, easily killed by fire. And when you take fire out of the system, you get a lot of juniper establishment. There probably is a role that is, I think, relatively poorly understood, although it's been explored in a series of papers led by Paul Dosher, late professor at Oregon State University. He was hypothesizing that spaces created in sage and native bunchgrass cover were pretty important to juniper establishment, which may or may not be related to cattle grazing. I think that there's some pretty complex biotic and abiotic interactions that are responsible for juniper expansion. There's an edaphic or soil control on it. I think this is all me trying to say that I don't really know for sure. But fire exclusion, grazing, many rangelands in eastern Oregon are significantly degraded by the past 100, 150 years of land use practices. It uses a lot of water. The reason it uses a lot of water is because it transpires water at high summer temperatures. That's what makes it drought tolerant, what it makes it be able to survive temperatures that would kill other conifer species.
All right. Our last question of the evening. Our forests will be experiencing a hotter, drier climate in the future. How should we tailor restoration strategies in light of a changing climate?
I wrote in a paper, I've written in a number of papers, that if we want to restore historical conditions, we have to significantly reduce forest density and shift species composition from drought intolerant, shade tolerant, to drought tolerant, shade intolerant species like ponderosa pine. And you probably should be asking yourself, well, what does history have to do with it? Why should we, you know, return stands to historical conditions? And I think the biggest and most important answer is because those are the conditions that are better adapted to the future. I think going back to the past is the path forward for the future. Forests that are less dense and are dominated by old fire-tolerant species like ponderosa pine, species that have stood the test of time, and this goes back to my answer about drought years, 1581, 1757, 1840, 1823. Those old-growth ponderosa pines have survived bigger droughts than we've had in the past 100 years, and they will survive the big droughts that are going to happen in the 100 years to come. So my answer to the question is sort of my message for tonight. To prepare for the future of warmer temperatures and more fire, we need to protect old-growth trees by reducing forest density and shifting species composition to ponderosa pine and western larch. I think it's a good way to end. I appreciate it. Thanks so much for having me.
Thanks so much, everyone. Have a great night.